In the long ago, God gave a promise to Abraham to give him a land along with his descendants. We see this initially in Genesis, the 12th chapter, in verse 1, where it says that Yahweh had said unto Abram, "Get thee out of thy country and from thy kindred and from thy father's house into a land that I will show thee." So, leave your father's land, go to the land I'll show you. Later on in chapter 15 and verse 18, it says that in the same day Yahweh made a covenant with Abram, saying, "Unto thy seed have I given this land, from the river of Egypt unto the great river, the river Euphrates." So here God says to Abraham, still Abram at this time, but Abraham, that I'm going to give you this land. Thy descendants, or thy seed, I'm going to give this land to. From this point, Abraham, his children went into Egypt to escape a great famine that had come upon the land. The Egyptians, because of the number of the children of Israel, they began to subjugate them, put them into slavery. So Israel cried unto God, and God sent unto them a great deliverer who would be Moses. And Moses, one of his jobs was to deliver the children of Israel from Egyptian bondage. He goes into Pharaoh, tells Pharaoh, "Let my people go, that they might worship me." And so, of course, we know the story of how Pharaoh refused to allow the children of Israel to leave. And finally, with a very strong hand, God brings them out of Egypt, bringing 10 plagues upon the Egyptians, so and convincing both the Egyptians and Pharaoh to let the children of Israel leave. They first go to Mount Zion or Mount Sinai and receive the law there, along with not just the 10 commandments, but all of the law, and the instructions as to making the tabernacle and all of the details of it. And then they leave there. They go to the land of Canaan, that land that God said to Abram, "I'm going to give you this land." And when they get there, they send 12 spies into the land. They spy out the land and come back. And 10 of those spies come back with a report. The people are giants there. The cities are walled. We can't take the land. And they discourage the people. On the other hand, you have Joshua and Caleb, the other two spies. And really what we're going to be using for our text this morning and Lord willing next Lord's Day morning is found in Numbers the 13th chapter in verse 30. Because now then, after hearing that report of the spies, or the 10 spies, and their discouraging report, it says that Caleb stilled the people before Moses and said, "Let us go up at once and possess it, for we are well able to overcome." What a beautiful contrast and courage that we see in relationship to Caleb and Joshua as opposed to these other 10 spies. They saw, yes, the same thing. The same cities, the same people, the same land. And one says, "We can't do it." Here's Joshua and Caleb. "Yes, we can. Let's do it."
I want us in these two lessons, though, to look at and to consider some lessons that from what Caleb says here. Let us go up at once and possess it, for we are well able to overcome it. And first, that phrase, those two words, let us. Salvation is an individual matter. These 10 spies brought back an evil report. We can't do it. The land is, yes, it's a great land, but the cities are walled. The people there are giants. We're grasshoppers in their sight, and yea, even in our own sight. We can't do this. The people, the Israelites, after hearing that report of the 10 spies, they believe that report. We can't do this. We can't go into the land and take it. Here is Joshua and Caleb, though. And now then that you have all of the people basically saying and agreeing with the report of the 10 spies, yes, we can do it. Let's go up and possess the land. Joshua and Caleb brought back a good report in spite of the 10 spies that brought a negative report. They presented a good report, good in the sense and bad in the sense of going in and taking the land. They presented that good report in spite of the fact that the people now were saying, we can't do it, and believing the report of the 10 spies. But salvation, what we see in that, because Joshua and Caleb were right in their assessment, and while the children of Israel died in wilderness wanderings, Joshua and Caleb were able to enter into the promised land. None of the other people were. Their salvation, and in this case, their ability to enter into the land and possess the land, was not dependent upon the other 10 spies, nor was it dependent upon the people, because it is an individual matter. That's true in relationship to all obedience in relationship to God. Our obedience is individual in nature. In Hebrews 3 and verse 12, the Hebrew writer says, take heed, brethren, lest there be in any of you an evil heart of unbelief in departing from the living God. An evil heart in you, individual in nature. And the Hebrew writer was writing to those who were Jews who were going back into Judaism, leaving Christianity. And he says that all of those individuals are doing so, there's an evil heart of unbelief in them. But you don't have to. You don't have to have that evil heart of unbelief like all of the others. It wouldn't matter if the whole world was going one way. You could still be saved. Isn't that what one of the great lessons that we learn back in Genesis the 6th through the 9th chapter? That here God is determined to destroy the world. Why? Because every imagination of man's heart was only evil continually. But Noah, one man, Noah found grace in the eyes of the Lord. Why? Because Noah was obedient to God. But wait a minute, the entire world was lost. The entire world, their only thought was evil continually. But that didn't force Noah to have that same mindset and that same attitude, did it? Noah could still be righteous in spite of a wicked, sinful world that he was living in. Now, let's face it. We live in our society today, we live in a wicked, sinful world. But their sinfulness does not mean that we cannot still be righteous. Just like Caleb, Joshua, their report was good in spite of the ten. They presented that report in spite of the people already accepting the ten's evil report, because they recognized their individual responsibility in regards to God in giving that report, and that God would bless them. When we look at salvation and our salvation, when we go through, and as we refer to it, the steps of salvation, which one of them is not an individual step? There's not a one of them. No one can do them for me, nor can I do them for you. When I hear God's word, I've got to hear it. It doesn't do me any good if somebody else hears the word and I don't. Since faith comes by hearing and hearing by the word of God, if I don't hear that word, and that's hearing it with acceptance in that sense, it's not going to do me any good, is it? If I don't come to faith, the whole world around me might have faith, but if I don't, that's not going to do me any good. Because faith is an individual matter. I've got to be brought to faith. My individual faith. When we repent of our sins. Oh, Joe Blow over here, he can't repent for me. I've got to do it myself. It's an individual matter. I am the one who has to confess my faith in Jesus Christ as being God's Son. It's not going to help me any at all if so-and-so over here confesses their faith if I don't do it, because it's an individual matter. And being baptized, it's an individual matter. I have to make that decision to be baptized, and I have to obey from the heart that form of doctrine which was delivered, but I have to do it from the heart. That is, I have to do it with my understanding, my knowledge, my will, my decision. No one can make those decisions for me. And I realize when we have children growing up, a lot of times we wish we could make that decision for them. And sometimes parents try to force that decision upon their children, and it doesn't work. Those children, not many times when they grow older, will apostatize. Why? Because it was never their decision to begin with. The decision has to be on an individual basis as to their obedience. That is obeying from the heart that form of doctrine. So baptism is an individual matter in being baptized for the remission of sins. No one can do it for us. And so every step in the salvation process is individual in nature. When we are commanded to come together to worship our God, worship is an individual matter. The songs that we sing, those psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs, I can go through the motions of singing the words, but if I'm not thinking about them, I'm not worshiping God. Worship is not just going through actions, it's also the attitude of heart. It is thinking and centering our minds upon what we are saying and what we are doing. Even if everyone around me is singing, if I'm not singing, not going to do me any good. I have to do the action with the right thought or with the right mindset. That's in truth and in spirit. John 4, 23 and 24. And so, yes, I've got to sing myself. No one can sing for me. even though some people might want to at times and say, you know, you sing so bad, you don't need to. Well, yes, I do, because nobody can do it for me. And I can't do it for anyone else. It's an individual basis. But I have to do it with the right attitude of heart. If everyone in this assembly was singing the songs that we sang this morning with the right attitude of heart, and I was singing them not thinking about the words, and my mind's over all here in Timbuktu, I haven't worshiped. Now, everyone else might have worshiped acceptably, but I didn't, because worship is an individual matter. The prayers that are prayed, same thing. We might have the prayers that we say, but unless we're thinking about it, they're no value to us. In 1 Corinthians 14th chapter, when he talks about, I will pray with the Spirit and I will pray with the understanding also. That's in dealing with public prayers. There's an individual leading that prayer, but he is giving and setting forth the thoughts of everyone within that assembly. How do we know that? Else how shall they that hear say amen at the giving of thanks? They have to be able to say amen. What is it? They've taken those words that have been stated by that one who is leading in the prayer. They're leading the thoughts of everyone. And they can then say amen. Let it be so. This prayer that has been prayed is my prayer. It's my petitions going up to God. But again, same thing. If everyone in this assembly was praying acceptably to God, and here's someone, just tell you the personal standpoint, me and my thoughts are not there, then everyone else might have worshipped acceptably, but I didn't, because worship is an individual matter. The same can be said in relationship to the Lord's Supper and the partaking of the Lord's Supper. Same can be said in relationship to our giving, our contribution. And yes, the same thing can be said in relationship to our study of God's Word, in that preaching of the Word. Our thoughts, our attitude has to be there in relationship to that study of God's Word. And if you know, I can be up here preaching my heart out. If you're not paying attention, I might be worshiping acceptably, but you're not. And some, I guess it would be difficult for me not to be thinking about what I'm saying, but I guess it might be possible some way, somehow. But we have to be centering our minds upon our worship. Why? Because worship is an individual matter. I have to worship God. You have to worship God as an individual. And no matter what everyone else in that assembly might be doing, if I'm not doing that, then I'm not worshiping acceptably. No matter what they are doing, living the Christian life is also an individual matter. I've got to live for Christ. I've got to do what He sets forth. I've got to have and add those Christian graces that are described in 2 Peter, the first chapter. I've got to put on the fruit of the Spirit. I've got to have love as described in 1 Corinthians 13. I've got to do that in relationship to my life, my attitudes, my thoughts, my actions. Because Christianity is an individual religion. And also, judgment is going to be individual in nature. In 2 Corinthians 5 and verse 10, told that all must appear before the judgment seat of Christ, there's the universality of it. We're all going to be there. That everyone, there's the individual nature of it, may receive the things done in his body according to that he hath done, whether it be good or bad. And notice again, that individual nature according to that he hath done. It's not according to what someone else did. Now, one of the problems with Calvinism is that we are lost, we are stand condemned before God because of what someone else did, not because of what I have done. Salvation is individual in matter. A discussion that I've been having on Facebook in relationship to this is a person who baptizes someone, must he be a Christian? And the answer is no. One of the reasons that no one has responded to is the individual nature of the judgment. Calvinism, on the one hand, says you're condemned because based upon the basis of someone else. This view would take you're saved based upon the salvation of someone else. And neither position is right. They're both wrong, because it is individual in nature. It's what I have done, not what someone else has done. Now then, that does not mean that we do not work together. Let us. It is a collective unit. They're going to work together in going up to the land and possessing the land. And so, yes, we work together, but each one of us make an individual decision in relationship to that work to do the work. In 1 Corinthians, the third chapter, in verse 9, Paul says, we are laborers together with God. You're God's husband, you're God's building. But notice that we, as a whole, are laborers together with God. There's our working together with God. But there is a working together nature of it. And in fact, Paul has mentioned, here I am, I planted, Apollos watered, God gave the increase. What is it? Here's Paul and Apollos working together and converting people. And they're working with God. So we are laborers together, working together. In 2 Corinthians, the sixth chapter, in verse 1, we then, as workers together with God, or actually with Him is not in the original, but we then as workers together, beseech you also that ye receive not the grace of God in vain. But we're workers together in this. We're working together. And yes, Caleb's plea to the people, while it's individual in nature, accept the truth that we can go in and possess the land because God is going to be with us. But we need to do this together. And then he says, let us go up at once. We must not delay our salvation. In 2 Corinthians, the 6th chapter and verse 1, after discussing in the 5th chapter the reconciliation that is to take place between God and man, he says, for he has said, I have heard thee in a time accepted, and in the day of salvation have I succored thee. Behold, now is the accepted time. Behold, now is the day of salvation. That day of salvation is now. It's not to be put off indefinitely, but it is something that needs to be done now. Don't delay it. In Hebrews 3 and verse 15, it says, while it is said, today if ye will hear his voice, harden not your hearts as in the provocation. Don't harden your hearts. If you hear his voice, obey it today. Salvation is far too precious to put it off, to delay it. One of the questions that when someone asks me about a young person who's growing up and they want to be baptized, and you kind of wonder, are they ready to be baptized? One of the lessons I learned long ago, and I was on the wrong side of it then and learned better, was to see if you can put it off. See if they will delay their obedience. If they are willing to delay their obedience, then they don't really understand the need for it. You see, here we are in a lost condition. We are separated from God. That which is ahead of us eternally is an eternal hellfire of torment. Now then, I know what it takes to escape that torment. By what reason can anyone give to delay escaping that torment? You see, if a child doesn't understand those principles, then yes, well, let's put it off until next week or next month or whatever. And, okay, well, we'll do that. They're not ready. They don't really understand the concept of eternal salvation and what it's dealing with. They still need more study and more understanding. That's one of the questions that I ask now in relationship to that young child. Why? Because to see if they have that understanding, that I'm not going to delay this. I don't care what you say. You can talk till you're blue in the face. I know my salvation is dependent upon this, and I know I need to be saved, and I need to do it right now. Now, that's a child who's understanding and has the need, then he's ready to be baptized. Why? Because he has an understanding that now is that accepted time. You can't delay it. You can't put it off. It's too precious to put off, to delay it. And there's also the understanding that there are things that might happen, that might take place, that would prevent our accepting of it. In the Hebrew letter, Paul is, I believe, to be the human author. He says, "Today, if you will hear his voice, harden not your hearts." What is it? Your heart might be hardened by sin. In Ephesians 4 and verse 19, he talks about people who are being past feeling, have given themselves over to lasciviousness, to work all uncleanness with greediness. They are past feeling. The feeling that they had of sorrow for sin and their offense of God and His nature has now become dull so that it doesn't bother them anymore. They aren't bothered by sin. They become hardened as a result of the sin that they are involved in or that they see. And as a result, being past feeling, it's not that salvation is not still available to them, but that they have become such that they will not accept the truth. They will not obey it. Why? Because of them. Not because it's not available to them, but because they have rejected it to such an extent that they will not obey. That's always a possibility. And so we have to understand, you don't delay your obedience. You obey now. But also, it's possible that we might lose control of our reasoning power. Salvation is based upon our ability to reason correctly. We reason correctly concerning the existence of God. We reason correctly concerning Jesus, that He is the Son of God, and that He died for our sins. We reason correctly concerning sin and our need to change and repent of those sins. We reason correctly when we are giving our confession of our faith that we believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God. What is that? That's a statement of our reasoning powers. When we are baptized in water, we are using our reasoning powers that we were lost, and this is that act that places us into a right relationship with God. It is that ability that has the power to wash those sins away. No wonder Isaiah would say in the long ago for God, "Come now, let us reason together, saith the Lord. Though your sins be as scarlet, they shall be as white as snow. Though they be red as crimson, they shall be as wool." Isaiah 1 and verse 18. What is it? There's a reasoning power in having your sins washed away. It's possible that we lose that ability to reason correctly. An injury might take place in which it affects our brain, our minds, and we lose that reasoning power. Or a medical condition might arise that on the spur of the moment just hits one that causes them to lose those reasoning powers. We have that. It can happen to us at any time, at any place. We can lose that ability to reason and thus lose that ability to be saved because we cannot reason correctly concerning salvation. It might be that we die. Life is fleeting. James would describe it as a vapor that appeareth for a little time and then vanisheth away. We have a fleeting period of time here upon this earth. And no one knows when we're going to die. Death is certain for sure. We're all going to die unless, of course, Christ comes back the second time prior to our death. But otherwise, we're going to die. Ecclesiastes, the 12th chapter, and that description of growing older points to the fact of death coming. How do we know? Because we've all gotten older. In the years that I've been here, all of you have gotten older. I'm glad I haven't, though. Well, there's a few more gray hairs and not as much hair on the top of my hair as when I came. And we've all gotten older. It points to a time that's coming that death is going to come upon us. Now, when? Don't know. But death is coming. And at that point of death, that opportunity to be saved is gone. There's no more opportunity once we die. As it is appointed unto man once to die, the Hebrew writer says, but after this, the judgment. Hebrews 9 and verse 27. Yes, that's an appointment we'll all keep of death. And after death, judgment. And then, of course, there's that aspect that Christ may come. We don't know when. In Matthew, the 24th chapter, the first part of that chapter deals with the destruction of Jerusalem, but the latter part, starting with verse 36 and going on through the 25th chapter, is dealing with the second coming of Christ. And he says repeatedly, no one knows when. And so he constantly encourages us, be prepared at all times. No one knows when the master of the house is coming, so you need to watch, be ready. But if we're delaying our obedience to Christ, we're not ready. Christ might come when we are not ready, and then our salvation will be lost, and we will be eternally damned. And then we need to do this at once because salvation is very simply too precious to lose. Salvation is precious and we know the value of it because of what it cost. It cost God Himself leaving heaven's home and that equality that He had with the Father to come to this world, to live as man is, to be tempted in all points like as we are, yet without sin, and then to die upon the death of the cross. There's the value of our soul. There's the value of our salvation. there's no other way that man could have been saved and can be saved other than by the blood of Jesus Christ. Blood of bulls and goats, Hebrew writer says, it's not able to take away sin. It had to be by the precious blood of Christ. We're not redeemed, Peter says, by corruptible things, gold, silver, precious stones, all of these things. They could not redeem even one soul. But we are redeemed by the precious blood of Christ as a lamb without spot, without blemish. There's the cost of our salvation. That salvation that costs so much is so precious. Jesus would state in Matthew the 26th chapter, or the 16th chapter in verse 26. And he would ask the question, what is man profited if he gain the whole world and lose his own soul? What shall man give in exchange for soul? The value of salvation is seen by the death of Jesus Christ, but it's also seen by the value of the soul itself. That God breathed into man's nostrils the breath of life, and man became a living soul. Now then, that eternal spirit that has been placed within man, eternal from the standpoint of when we are created or when man, we are conceived, we're going to live eternally. That soul is valuable. It's of more value than everything that this world has to offer. That value should show us that salvation is far too precious to delay. That we need to obey. And we need to obey now. As Paul says there, now is the day of salvation. Not tomorrow, not some other time. Our salvation is too precious to lose. It costs too much for us to delay obedience. And so if you have not obeyed that gospel of Jesus Christ, it's an individual matter. No one can do it for you. You must do it yourself. And if you have not, and we would plead with you to obey that gospel of Jesus Christ this morning. Let us, upon your faith, repenting of your sins and the confession of your faith, baptize you in water for the forgiveness of your sins. If you haven't lived the Christian life, as God said, salvation is too precious. It costs too much for you to stay away and not be restored to faithfulness to God, through letting us pray with you for the forgiveness of your sins. So if you need to respond to this invitation of our Lord, we would encourage you to do that as we stand and sing the invitation song.